Hoot hoot, everyone. It's me, your boy, that there Turbo Owl. I said your boy again, guys. I keep forgetting to stop saying it. It's, you know what? It's made worse by the fact that I've got dyed hair now. The fact that I said that. Because now it seems even less ironic saying your boy when I've got blue hair. Ah, well, such is life. Anyway, it's me, that there Turbo Owl. Ethan, and I'm just here doing something that I have been very excited to do for a while now, and that is I am finally going to be able to stream Total War Warhammer 3. Yes, the game doesn't come out for another week, but I've been playing it for a week, and let me tell you, I am very happy with what I've played. I've already got about 50 hours in it, although the vast majority of that time is made up of two campaigns, those being Kislev and Nurgle. So I'm not going to be playing Kislev or Nurgle today. Going to start another campaign. Why are you still awake, Edward? Why are you still awake? You've got an actual job. What are you doing here? Anyway, so let's just get into it. What my plan is I'm going to be, I'm just going to talk about a bunch of the new things, maybe show off some things about the campaigns just by kind of hopping into the campaigns I've already got, and then we're going to start a new campaign. I'm leaning towards, I'm hopefully going to have made my mind up by the time I get to that. I'm either going to do Cathay or Tzeentch. I would do Nurgle because, you know. But unfortunately, that was the one I just completed. Yeah, that was the most recent one. So, yeah, that's why I'm not doing that one. Trust me, unless it turns out that I absolutely hate one of the factions, which so far that doesn't seem likely, I will get around to doing full playthroughs of each faction eventually. So I've been at work today. I haven't really drank much water. But we're not starting with Nurgle for that reason. I mean, I'd even be more willing to start with Kislev, because Kislev has got the most legendary lords out of it. It's got the most start positions out of every faction. It's also worth noting, I will not be talking about or showing off the Ogre Kingdoms in this stream or in any streams until, I think, the 14th. Because for reasons I don't fully understand, at a guess, it's because they're technically DLC. The Ogre Kingdoms are actually under a separate embargo, different from the rest of the game. Also, I've finally gotten around to replacing the two Dongzhuo Kakapos with, let me just quickly, Boris Bocca over there, and Kugath Plaguefather over here. I don't think I've ever done anything of any substance on Total War Three Kingdoms, so the fact that I had two fucking pieces of artwork from that with owl heads on always struck me as weird. Anyway, let's get into it and let's talk about all the new things. Because let me tell you, Total War Warhammer 3 is pretty fucking good. Okay, so I'm going to just hit this transition button here. I will also warn you, and yes, it is black right now because I have to run the game in full screen. I will also warn you that, let me put it this way. My computer doesn't run this particularly well. I am working on getting a new graphics card. It's looking like I should have it in early March. But for the moment, I don't. We're just going to have to... I know OBS picks this up. It's just... There we go. Okay, so obviously this is the current UI. It's... well, the new UI. It's a bit peculiar. It did throw me off for a while, but I have gotten used to it by now. This is, of course, obviously a pre-release build still. I can't imagine there's going to be too many changes between, like, now and the final release, but this is a pre-release build right here. Give Timmy a treat. I just started, and now I already have to give the dog a treat. Hi, Tim. The box that his treats come in is making it difficult to access his treats. Okay. Tim, up it. I don't. There you go. Oh, hey. Okay. And that's you going. Okay, right. See you later, dude. Go get some sleep. Stop being anxious the whole fucking night. Okay. So. But, I mean, you can see there, my current campaign's The Disciples of the Maw. As mentioned, can't cover that. Because that's under embargo, so you won't be seeing any of that. But yeah, so, obviously, you maybe immediately noticing there's a few peculiar things going on right here. We've got your standard, you know, load campaign, continue campaign. We've also got specifically multiplayer campaign and prologue. Now, we're not going to be playing the prologue, but I'll tell you what the prologue is because, and I'll also tell you the plot of the prologue, more or less, because the plot of the prologue is very important to the plot of the game. And let me tell you this little hint here. This is only made explicitly clear at the end of a campaign. I'm not going to give you the details of what happened in the plot of the campaign, because Warhammer 3 is actually surprisingly plot-heavy compared to Warhammer 1 and 2. Maybe not compared to Warhammer 2. But it's got a surprising emphasis on plot, and the prologue's an example of that. The prologue just 100% definitely happens in the narrative, and it takes place directly in the lead-up to the base Realm of Chaos campaign. I think that's what the this generic campaign's called, the standard campaign's called. There are also multiplayer campaigns. I'm not going to play one here, but you can see here we've got three multiplayer campaigns. The Realm of Chaos, which is the standard campaign map. Darkness and Disharmony, which is one focusing more on Cathay, and Something Rotten in Kislev. These are all multiplayer. I've not played them. I don't play multiplayer. But people like them, is what I've been led to understand. And the multiplayer campaigns are now up to, I think, Realm of Chaos and Darkness and Disharmony, 8 players. Something Rotten in Kislev is 3 players, and it's simultaneous turns and stuff. All good things. But we're not doing that. Oh, hello. Someone's the very long, hard message. Hello, this is going to be cheesy, but I've been watching you for many years on YouTube, and this is the first time I managed to catch one of your streams. I'd like to say thank you very much for... you're trying to bring content and all the help your content has done for me. Well, that is... thank you. I'm glad you... I've gotten a few messages of people saying they really like my stuff and watch reviews. I never know how to respond. Thank you. I'm glad you like it. Thanks. That's thrown me off. Someone said something nice and it's thrown me off. Anyway, I'll talk... Prologue! I was talking about the prologue! So... The prologue, has you playing as... Kislev, as you're playing as a character by the name of Yuri, who appears to be, it's vaguely indicated, the lover of Queen of Tsarina Katerina of Kislev, as he has gone off to try to figure out what has happened to the bear god Ursun. And he follows what he believes to be Ursun's voice into the Chaos Wastes, there to find him chained up by Belakor, the Lord of Shadow, the first demon prince. He is, throughout this, essentially corrupted by Belakor without knowing it, and is ultimately convinced that he is superior to the bear god Ursun, and thus betrays Ursun and Kislev, attempting to kill the bear god. Instead, he severely wounds him and is sent out of the Realm of Chaos, out of the Forge of Souls, where Belakor has imprisoned Ursun, and he is left there to rot and die in the snow. He then, however, if we... we'll just jump over that there. We will watch that cutscene when I actually start a campaign properly. He then does actually become a legendary lord, however, but not for Kislev. That's who the Demon Prince is. Despite how heavily customized he is, and despite the fact that you can pick the Demon Prince's name, the Demon Prince leading the Chaos Undivided Demons of Chaos faction is in fact Yuri from the prologue. As I said, we're not going to be watching the prologue, we're not going to be playing it, because it is functionally an extended tutorial with a narrative added to it. I will say this, the combination of this game having so much more narrative in that, and having a relatively compelling start there, and having a much more direct tutorial in the form of the prologue, does weirdly make Warhammer 3 the most immediately kind of new player friendly of the games. It is also worth noting that, unlike Warhammer 1, which starts with the coronation of Karl Franz and otherwise doesn't really have any plot, it's just Karl Franz was just coronated. Whoops, here comes the end times. Here comes Archaon. And unlike Warhammer 2 that takes place at the exact same time, the Vortex just going on elsewhere in the world. The main plot, the main map of Realm of Chaos, of Warhammer 3, the Realm of Chaos campaign, is a prequel to Warhammer 1 and 2. Now, I had been curious about this, and I'd actually been wrong. I'd thought that on the assumption that the events are all happening at the same time, I had thought the reason the demons were able to be present was because of the destabilization of the Vortex. I did not know what the broader plot was at the time, but that would have made sense, temperament. That would have made sense, you know, because demons, they require an excess of magic to be present. That would have made sense to me. However, the Vortex campaign, the War for the Vortex, hasn't happened. Because, well, it's part of the reason about why the advisor seems so young. Is that this ends the very last shot of the game, and we'll see this in a cutscene eventually. It ends with the advisor leaving whichever one of the factions he serves and being found by a small white crow, which, if you will recall, if you played Warhammer 1, you will recall, especially if you played the Warriors of Chaos campaign in Warhammer 1, that crow is Sartorial the Everwatcher, who ultimately consumes the advisor and joins the Warriors of Chaos in trying to destroy the world. Or if you're playing the Warriors of Chaos campaign, he becomes an enemy that you have to overcome in the Warriors of Chaos campaign. It really surprised me to find out that this isn't taking place at the same time, but that Warhammer 3 is a direct prequel to the events of Warhammer 1 and 2. This, however, makes me feel like the fact that he then, we know, goes on to be directly involved in the events of the future games, makes me think that maybe this might be hinting, or maybe kind of trying to build a little bit of hype for the inevitable Warriors of Chaos rework. Because that still means that the ultimate fate of these campaigns is the arrival of Archaon and the End Times, which presumably is going to be in some way connected to the final map, the Immortal Empires, Immortal Empires 3 map. Okay. So, you know what? Should we watch? I mean, I could show you the movies in the prologue, I think. Yeah, I could show you these. How come you got this so early? I'm a verified content creator. I think that's what they're called. Creative Assembly has a program for for some YouTubers and streamers that we get review copies and stuff ahead of time. I get review copies of everything CA puts out. It's just that I mostly only play the Warhammer stuff. Hang on. I'm trying to remember what the fuck my title actually, like, what the actual title is. Because there's like two sets of people. There's the big guys who got it much earlier than the rest of us, and then there's like the tier I'm in. Yeah, like the big guys are called content partners, and then the rest of us are verified content creators. So that's why. it's because of that. I've had this since the third. You know, I've had this for a week, and I've just been playing the shit out of it. Okay. I can show you that. Woo-hoo-hoo-hoo-hoo-hoo-hoo! You happy? Okay. Again, the goofy running off a cliff. Just by far the most confusing thing for people who watch the VOD after the fact. Because they don't know it's coming. Okay. Do I want to continue talking about stuff, or do I want to show... You know what? I'll go through all the cutscenes and stuff. I'll show you all the stuff once I've talked about the individual factions a bit, and once we've decided who we're going to play, and once we're building up to that. Because we're basically going to be doing, I think... I'm going to show these three. I think the Tome of Fates is the standard introduction. Like, it's literally the cutscene that plays when you open the game, which I think introduces the nature of the advisor and his role in the world. By the way, it's wild to me how much more of a character the advisor is in this. Like, they really went out of their way to make the advisor, like, important. in this. Like, he is a full-fledged character. I mean, he was always a mysterious figure in Warhammer 1. Warhammer 2, he was there, but he wasn't really... There wasn't any indication of if he was even present in the narrative, so I don't honestly think he was. I think the advisor has been present for the narrative elements of 1 and 3, but was just there in 2 as a gameplay thing. Because he never showed up in cutscenes, there was never any explanation for what he was doing there. So there we go. Be able to do that, and then we'll talk about the... And then, but once we've, once I've picked which faction we're going to play as, we'll go through that. Okay. So we'll hit the new campaign button, we'll skip the, that cutscene, and I'm going to talk about the individual factions. Now, I am going to warn you, I have not played all of the individual factions all that much. At the moment, I have played a full campaign of Kislev, a full campaign of Nurgle, some Tzeentch, some Khorne, no Slaanesh, a tiny bit of Grand Cathay, enough to get a little bit of a sense of them, but not much. And I'm currently playing an Ogre Kingdoms campaign in my own time, but I'm going to avoid talking about the Ogre Kingdoms because... Embargo still! I'm still not allowed to talk about the Ogre Kingdoms. But there we go. Okay, so we'll start about... I'll start with the campaigns I've played the most of, and honestly, the faction that has the most legendary lords, has the most start options, and that is... Kislev. Now, Kislev, oddly, was... It was weirdly the faction I was the least excited for, and yet then when the game came out, they were the ones I defaulted to. I guess it's for a simple reason. It's partially because recommended first campaign. The Kislev are, for lack of a better term, the Empire, or the High Elves of Warhammer 3. In that they are kind of the go-to standard faction. Though, having said that, they are kind of weird when compared to the High Elves or the Empire, because Kislev has a really heavy emphasis on hybrid units. Honestly, all of the factions in Warhammer 3 have a lot more mechanics to them than, you know, factions in the base game factions in Warhammer 2 or Warhammer 1. It very much feels like Creative Assembly have basically started leaning more heavily towards the very unique mechanics that became present in kind of the latter half of Warhammer 2's DLC, and have made that kind of the standard for every faction, rather than the base game factions being pretty normal, pretty bog standard in terms of how they're very similar in terms of how they play on the campaign map. Warhammer 3 is very much, they're all very disparate from each other, and then they're just going to get more peculiar as the DLC comes out. But yeah, so Kislev's already quite weird, but Kislev and Cathay are kind of the standard ones. However, it's also worth saying that, especially considering, you know, the dying god that everyone's fighting over is Ursun, and the demon prince is a former Kislevite who betrayed Ursun, Kislev appears to be the main characters, for lack of a better term. They are the protagonist faction, for lack of a better term. For Warhammer 3. I played as Tsarina Katarin, who, as you can no doubt tell just by looking at her, she is obviously the Ice Witch vibe. She is, as you often find in a lot of cases, she is the legendary lord equivalent of the generic Ice Witch lord type and hero type. She's quite good, decent melee. I quite enjoyed her. Her faction... She's, for lack of a term, the default faction of Kislev playing the actual ruling body. Starting, of course, in actual Kislev. Very close to the Empire, which is another reason why I wanted to play as her initially, is because, if you don't know, the world map looks very different. The actual campaign map has a very different style to it. I really like it, but it's been controversial for a lot of people, so I wanted to kind of see how it compared... How the set places I've already seen in Warhammer 1 and 2 compared to, you know, how they compared between, you know, 2 and 3. I prefer 3. I think 3 looks a lot cleaner. It looks less realistic, but then again, I always thought the world map of 2 was quite visually noisy. That's nowhere near as much of an issue in Warhammer 3. Looks a lot better. Her specialization is obviously ice witches and all that kind of stuff, and she has access to the Ice Court, which is a special way of training their frost maidens and ice witch heroes. It is worth noting, I had initially thought that Tsarina Katarin was going to be the only person who has access to that. They all do. As far as I can tell, there's no unique mechanics really per lord at the moment. They're just essentially different starting positions and slightly different buffs to kind of lead you to play in a different way. Okay. Then, of course, we have good old Kostatlin. Kostaltin? Who is rah-rah Rasputin, but for Kislev. Didn't play as him. He is essentially the direct opponent of Tsarina Katerin. As I'm sure you may know if you've been following it, Kislev has an entire thing built around basically the conflict between Kostaltin, representing the main church of Kislev, the Great Orthodoxy, and Tsarina Katerin. He, from what I've heard, is kind of a mixed... He's kind of an odd one in that he doesn't really have a great place as a legendary lord, for the simple reason that he is essentially a legendary lord equivalent of what is a support hero. I've basically seen a lot of comparisons between him and Volkmar the Grim, but he doesn't have, like, a big, cool altar like Volkmar, so he's just kind of... He's in an odd place because he doesn't have any magic. He's too squishy to really be, like, a duelist or a really good, like, frontline fighter. He's a bit peculiar. I like his look. However, he seems to be a bit of the red-headed stepchild of the game. Especially because, like, he just kind of got forgotten about after he was initially announced. There's not much to him. Also, his depiction in cutscenes is a lot better than his depiction in the actual game. Yeah, he's a bit of an odd one. And then we have the surprise legendary lord, who you have to unlock through gameplay. Basically, is by playing through the Kislev campaign, you will eventually unlock as either Kostaltin, or Tsarina Katerin. You will eventually get a quest battle, which will allow you to unlock Boris Ursus or Boris Booker, who is the Tsar of Kislev. That preceded Tsarina Katerin's father. When you unlock him in the campaign, you can either choose to have him basically start as his own faction, which is the Ursan Revivalists, or you can take him into your faction as a legendary lord. He is the legendary lord equivalent of the Boyar legendary lord, which is it's essentially a melee bruiser lord type. He's quite good in combat. He starts, as I said, in kind of an odd place, because he starts basically in the Darklands. But yeah, I haven't played his campaign. When I do a Kislev campaign in the future, chances are I'm going to be playing Boris Ursus. Just because he looks... I'm quite fond of his look. And also, he's in quite a different area of the map. He's quite a distance away. I mean, Kostaltin and Katerin are, like, relatively close together, because they are just... Basically, she's on one end of Kislev, he's on the other. Whereas fucking Boris Ursus is just fucking miles away in the Darklands for some reason. So I'd probably sign him just because it gives me a chance to play in an area which, honestly, doesn't have... I think that's the Darklands anyway. Yeah, because I think Kugath starts, like, up here... No, he starts up here, and I made my way in my campaign down here, and I'm pretty sure... Yeah, because the Mountains of Morn and shit are over here, and Cathay's up here. So yeah, this has got to be the Darklands. But yeah, that's Boris Ursus. As I said, Kislev are an interesting faction. They play... Actually, they're not even the closest to the Empire. The closest to the Empire is probably Cathay. For the simple reason that... The Kislevite army is very peculiar in that a lot of their units are hybrids. And I will say, I found after a certain while the Streltsy, who are the basically handgunners with axes on the butts of their guns, ended up becoming kind of my basic unit that I would use my front line for quite a while. The Streltsy were quite fun. Kislev, good stuff. Cathay. Can't talk about too much. I haven't actually had a chance to play as them, and we are going to be playing as Cathay, most likely, as I said. Either Cathay or Tzeentch. If I haven't made my mind up by the time I finish talking about the factions, I'm gonna flip a fucking coin. But Grand Cathay is there. Got kind of a peculiar relationship to the main campaign, in that they, by virtue of being dragons, don't actually give a shit about the involvement of the gods. They're rather seeking to use Ursun to find a missing member of their family. It was theorized by a lot of players that, much like Boris Ursus was a unlockable lord for Kislev, that this sister, I think Shenzhou, would be an unlockable lord for Grand Cathay. That doesn't seem to be the case. I don't know how their plot resolves, but there it is. They are, aside from the presence of their more unusual units, like the Terracotta Sentinel, and obviously the presence of their dragon legendary lords, they are the closest to being a standard human army. They do have the yin and yang stuff. A lot of the most unique things from what I've seen about Cathay do come essentially out of their campaign mechanics, which are quite interesting in the whole yin and yang system. I will say, right off the bat, while if we do play Cathay, I'm going to play as Miao Ying, because she's, for lack of a term, the standard legendary lord for Cathay, more so than Zhao Ming. I do vastly prefer Zhao Ming's personality. He seems like a good lad, but Miao Ying is, she's the go-to. Also, looks a little bit dark elfy to me. I don't know, something about her color palette, specifically. Looks a bit dark elfy. Okay. Ogre Kingdoms, skipping over them. Khorne is more or less as you would expect. Very, very melee heavy. Everything about playing as Khorne, everything about playing as Scarbrand the Exile, it's all about just rushing headlong into battle over and over and over and over and over and over and over again. Oddly, he can engage in diplomacy. Ah, and this is where something's worth noting. There is a hard line between Order factions and Chaos factions, with the only person able to step over that line, I think, being Slaanesh. I believe that Slaanesh can enter into diplomatic pacts with non-Chaos factions. But if you are playing as Nurgle, Khorne, Tzeentch, or the Demons of Chaos as a whole, upon meeting a non-Chaos faction... that's not fair. Upon meeting a specifically Order faction, you will be automatically at war with them, and you will be for the entire game. There is no getting around it. Unless you are Slaanesh, they will not deal with demons. Now, this doesn't apply to everyone. I believe you can still make deals with Orcs and Skaven. I can't remember if you can make deals with the vampire counts. But at the very least, the Skaven, the Norskins, the Warriors of Chaos, and I believe Greenskins, and the Ogres, actually, the Ogre Kingdoms as well, are all still willing to do diplomacy with the Demons of Chaos. It's just the strict Order factions will never talk to Chaos. To put it in kind of Age of Sigmar terms, Order and Chaos don't mix. Destruction and Chaos can mix, and Destruction and Order can mix. But there is a hard line between Order and Chaos. They do not interact with each other unless you're playing as Slaanesh. Khorne, as I said, very fast moving. Haven't really played enough of Scarbrand's campaign to get too much of a sense of how he plays. Also, I feel like they're going to want to change that picture at some point. Because I just realized Tzeentch. Yeah, because they are obviously going to be releasing more legendary lords down the line for these factions in DLC. I've seen some people theorizing that one of the Lord packs will probably end up being Grand Cathay, the Monkey King, versus Tzeentch's the Changeling, which would be quite a fun one. But yeah, Khorne's faction, very hard-hitting, quite fast-moving. It's what you'd expect of a very melee-heavy army. Also, the only... one of the two factions, Chaos factions, that makes frequent use of mortals. I will say this, you really do feel the absence of mortals, especially when I was playing my Nurgle campaign. You really feel, at least in terms of like the fantasy of playing Chaos. You know, you always imagine you get your Chaos Warriors, your marked Chaos Warriors, and only when shit starts getting really real do like the Plague Bearers and the Great Unclean Ones come out. Whereas like when you obviously playing as the Demons of Chaos, I mean, you start with Bloodthirsters as or Bloodletters. Shit, which ones? Hang on. It'll tell me if I click on Scarbrand. Nope, it just says the greatest of all demons. I always get my Bloodthirsters and my Bloodletters mixed up. As Scarbrand, you start with, like, the small guys, the units of, like, human-sized corn demons, rather than Chaos Warriors. Even though he is, like, the one that has Chaos Warriors. For some reason, you start you start with Bloodthirsters or Bloodletters instead of Chaos Warriors. Haven't played much of him. I did start his campaign, played it a bit. Seems like it'd be quite fun, but this is when I was trying to decide what to play next, and I ended up settling on a Scrag the Slaughterer playthrough. Nurgle. Right. This I can talk about. Nurgle is the other faction that I played quite a bit of, as there we are, good old Kugath, Plague Father. Nurgle really threw me through a loop. Nurgle is weird. In fact, I'll go so far as to say all of the Chaos factions are weird. Probably the least weird of them would probably end up being the Legions of Chaos, led by the Demon Prince, by virtue of the fact that that's got the biggest roster in the fucking game, because it's got, like, all four of the smaller rosters of the Monogod factions, so they can kind of make up for, you know, you can mix and match to make up for the relative lacks and absences in each of the Monogod factions. But Nurgle is weird, both on the campaign map and in battle. In battle, Nurgle is a slow grinding match with surprisingly powerful magic and only a couple of really kind of decently fast moving units. Basically, I ended up heavily relying, especially by the end of the campaign, on plague drones and at the very later stages of the campaign, stuff I got from other factions. I'll talk about that. The diplomacy rework is fucking amazing. Diplomacy's a lot. Alliances are useful in Warhammer 3. Alliances were pointless. I never did them in Warhammer 2. Warhammer 3 alliances are the shit. Fucking love them. But in my Nurgle campaign, I made a lot of use of Skaven and Zeech units in the later stages, just so I had just something that can move quickly and wasn't plague drones. In terms of how they play on the campaign map, it is very fucking slow going. In fact, if I go back and I actually go to my load campaign here, you can see here, I've finished Kislev in about 160 turns. But you can see there, Pox Makers of Nurgle, 221. Granted, I also had a lot more map space there. I've took over, you know, a lot of the Mountains of Morn, large chunks of the Chaos Wastes, and bits of the Darklands there, as opposed to basically being confined to just Kislev in this campaign. But it's a very slow-going campaign with Nurgle. Their economy is shit, and from what I've been led to believe, that is true of all of the Chaos factions. They do not have a great economy. Because they're kind of intended to be played in a similar way to Norska, where you get a lot of your money from battle and raiding and destruction, rather than through actually having a strong economy. You know, meanwhile, fucking Kislev, Cathay, and the Ogre Kingdoms can have fucking wild economies. The demons, their economies all suck. I only had, like, three armies by the end of that campaign, and I was basically just playing whack-a-mole. And it took ages to even get to the point at which I could afford a second army. It's especially thrown off because all of their buildings take forever to build, and then they go through this peculiar, you know, that growth cycle. It means that you very much... I mean, to be fair, it means that you do have exactly the cycles you'd expect of growth, then you need to calm the fuck down because you can't afford to, you know, keep reinforcing your armies and shit like that, and then your growth gets back up as, you know, your buildings are basically ticking over, the amount of income you're making is ticking up, the amount of units you even have is going all over the place, because unlike other factions where as long as you're in X province you can pull anything from the recruitment buildings in that province, all of Nurgle's armies, wherever they are, have the ability to summon up any units they can recruit. However, these things are, it's because their military buildings don't so much provide the ability to just recruit anything, they add stuff to a pool every time it ticks over into a new cycle. Which means that if you've been having a lot of victories, if you've been on a winning streak, or if you've just not been fighting for a while, you can get quite a surplus of units. But if you die a lot, you get in trouble because you just literally, you can't reinforce them. Because you just can't get enough units. I found them quite fun, though they are quite weird. It took me a good while to get into the swing of them. They've got a bit of ranged, not too much. And the fastest thing they've got is plague drones, and plague drones aren't that tough. They're an odd one. I really enjoyed them, but Nurgle is an odd one, and it took me a while to work out how to play them. Slaanesh. Haven't touched it. Have not gone near Slaanesh. From what I understand of Slaanesh, Slaanesh plays very fast, very glass cannon, but with no fucking range outside of spellcasting. They're a flanking and cycle charging faction. They also, from what I understand, have some peculiar mechanics in regards to diplomacy and the seduction mechanic. Yeah, as you can see there, seduction, which allows you to basically steal units from enemy armies, which sounds like it could be quite interesting, but as I said, have not played them, just haven't played them. I just haven't actually touched Slaanesh at all. Fought Slaanesh a lot, not played them. But there you go. And then we have Tzeentch. And Tzeentch is, again, kind of an odd one. Tzeentch is a very, very ranged heavy faction. Very skirmish heavy. And I'll tell you this right now. Tzeentch, when you're playing as Nurgle especially, Tzeentch is fucking terrifying to fight against. Because there have been multiple occasions in which the Blue Horrors, the basic bitch standard, like, missile infantry, that's the thing, they don't have a standard front line. It's just Blue Horrors, it's just missile infantry, who are shit at melee. But the thing is, I'm gonna be honest with you, get enough Blue Horrors, it doesn't matter how bad they are in melee, chances are whatever's running at them is gonna be dead by the time they get there. Tzeentch can have an absolutely terrifying front line in the simple fact that they do a lot of damage and there's so fucking many magical things. Tzeentch is an absolute terror. Yeah, Tzeentch is an absolute terror from what little I've seen. Again, have not been able to play much of a Tzeentchian campaign as of yet, so I can't actually tell you one way or the other how good they actually are in the campaign. Was weird though. I have used several Tzeentch units. Because I was, weirdly, even though, like, Nurgle and Tzeentch actively hate each other, you know, those are the two, you know, all of the four Chaos Gods technically hate each other, but, you know, Khorne hates Slaanesh most of all, and Nurgle and Tzeentch hate each other most of all. I almost immediately ended up allied with Kairos Fateweaver when I was playing as Nurgle, and then would just supplement my armies whenever I could with, Tzeentch units, which was... Yeah, it gave me some experience with Tzeentch. Weirdly, I'll talk about that later. Yeah, kind of a camera out run. Demons of Chaos. I can't speak to them. Have not played their campaign. Deliberately avoided their campaign. Because I wanted to... given the fact that the Demons of Chaos faction has access to all of the Chaos Mono God faction units, I wanted to complete at least one campaign as a Mono God faction. Before I tried to play the Demon Prince, I'm now leaning more towards two, because I do want to also play Tzeentch. So I'm thinking, yeah, I'll do that. And the problem is, we've now gone to this point, I still don't know whether I want to play Tzeentch, or if I want to play Cathay. But you know what, I've got some more time, because I'm going to talk more about the actual campaign when we get into the actual campaign. But while I'm trying to make my mind up, let's watch the prologue cutscene, shall we? So we can, to give you the context that is required to understand the plot leading in to the campaign. And I hope I remembered my embargo correctly, in that it's all covered. Hang on a minute. Let me just very quickly double check my embargo. I will say this, right now, right off the bat, that I, am very happy. Very happy with Total War Warhammer 3. Could not be happier. I was worried that I'd be disappointed with it. I will say that it does suck that the game is a bit more demanding than Warhammer 2. While I'm streaming it, until I get my new graphics card, we will run into problems dealing with that. I guarantee we're going to run into issues with that. Sorry, I'm just checking my embargo to make sure I don't, Okay, cool, yeah, this is all fine. I was just checking, because as I said, there's some things I'm not allowed to show off. Actually, specifically said, you can't show the cutscenes without gameplay, but this is a whole fucking stream, so I think this, I think we're cool. Actually, that's something I will show as well, actually. There is another unlockable Legendary Lord. I'm just going to quickly hop into my campaign, one of my campaigns. I'll hop into Kislev. I think this will be a good example, and also it'll give me some indication as to how this is going to run. But I just want to show you another thing, because there is, in fact, two unlockable Legendary Lords. It's not just Boris Booker. There is another unlockable Legendary Lord. Unlike Boris Booker, however, this Legendary Lord does not unlock a new start position. He unlocks in the same way that Boris Todbringer and the Red Duke and Sothora the Everwatcher unlocked, in which they got added to the custom battle options. However, he does actually get added to your campaign. You can just unlock him in campaign as anyone. And he did specifically mention that you can show him. So we're just going to just boot into my Kislev campaign. And then we'll go have a look at the cutscenes leading into the prologue, you know, into the opening of the prologue. And then we'll either pick Cathay or Zeech. We'll have a look, and then I'll fucking change the name of the stream to let people know what I'm doing. I'll probably have to leave a comment in this when this actually goes live. But yeah, you can... Oh my god, this campaign. I don't know what it is. The Kislev campaign always ran like ass for me. I really don't know why. It looks worse on the stream than it does in reality, but
Bellacor.
Yeah. Bellacor. It's an odd little side point. But Bellacor, when you complete the Realm of Chaos campaign, when you, you know, fight your final battle against Bellacor at the very end, a little text box comes up saying, basically, Bellacor has been defeated, however he will do anything for a body. Zeench offers him a deal to get, to, you know, mean he gets to keep his physical form. However, Bellacor didn't ask any questions, and Zeench is a trickster. Which basically means that it's the explanation. Is basically Zeench said, "Yeah, I'll let you keep your physical body, but you have to work for whoever just beat you. That's the choice." So yeah, when you beat the campaign, if you choose to play it any further after the fact, you will have access to Bellacor as a legendary lord for your faction. I believe in custom battle, he is only available for the Demons of Chaos. But yeah, it's weird. From what I can tell, he seems to functionally just be a variant of the Demon Prince, of a customizable Demon Prince, especially in terms of how his, like, model moves and looks and behaves. But obviously you can't customize bits of him. He just seems to be, like, Bellacor is a variant Demon Prince. But yeah, that's just a... Also, it is worth noting... Damn. He's got an upkeep of 666. Okay. Let's get back to our menu here. Yeah, it's an odd one. Okay. I will say, as I said, I am running this on very low settings. So, in the hopes that it'll run. Weirdly, the battles run better than the campaigns. Like, consistently, the battles run better than the campaign. I don't know why. There you go. Okay. I don't know what, I was going to show you the bloody cutscenes leading up to appearance of... leading up to the actual selection here. Doesn't I? Yeah. I think... Yeah, I believe these are, like, actually mid-campaign cutscenes that everyone gets. Because, obviously, I mean, you can see they directly relate to Bellacor. And over here is the prologue stuff. So, yeah, let's just give these a watch while Ethan has a think about which faction he wants to play.
Kislev, our motherland, is dying. The dark winter devours her fairer seasons. A It has been custom for our god, Ursan, the Great Bear, to break each winter with his roar. Yet for 7 long years, he has fallen into silence. And so the ice thickens. Our prayers go unanswered. The people suffer. The Queen has sent me to investigate, to lead an expedition in search of Ursan. I am to make contact with our northernmost outpost, Dervingar. It was there, on the edge of the Chaos Wastes, our god's voice was last heard.
Let their courage be our courage.
Our journey has been long and perilous. The dead outnumber the living. We are lost. We are alone.
Your orders, Prince Yuri.
Fuel for the fires. Extra rations for the wounded.
Sir, this expedition has failed. We must turn south, head back to Kislev.
But we've come so far. We push north, find Dervingard.
It's madness! We cannot survive wandering the Chaos Wastes like beggars!
Yuri, brother, we must not abandon our duty. The people of Kislev depend on us.
You'll have my decision by dawn. Ursan, each day I pray, but you do not answer. This is our darkest night. Can you not see Kislev suffering? Help us! Show me a sign! Answer me! Then Kislev is lost.
Son of Kislev, I answer in my time of need.
Ursan!
I wake in darkness, bound in shadow.
Guide me! I can save you!
I am weak, so you alone shall hear my voice. I will lead you to Dervingard, your first step to finding me. Follow my voice.
We move north.
Okay. I've decided which faction we're playing, by the way. But I'll tell you that in a moment. It's also worth noting, during the prologue, you actually find evidence of a Kislevite boyar who came before you, who fell to chaos. And it turns out it is literally explicitly the guy from the that original trailer that showed a chaos warrior with like a big white bushy kind of facial hair going on. And you end up fighting him by the end of the campaign. He's like at the end of the prologue. He is like the final boss of that. With kind of a mixed chaos army. Although weirdly you also have a bloodthirster with you at that point, or a bloodletter. The big one, the big flying red one. It's an interesting one. Basically over the course of the journey, Yuri finds and begins using various chaos artifacts, and he becomes visibly more corrupted on his journey there, and becomes basically increasingly dickish to the people around him as he attempts to find Ursan.
The Howling Citadel was mine.
Yeah, as you can see by the time you get
had been sacrificed. Yeah. I feel no remorse, only power.
Yeah, as you can see, he's obviously a bit fucking evil by this point.
Through this portal lies my god. I am ready.
From the shadow.
I am the shadow.
Bellacor, where is Ursan?
Ah, yes. The god who abandoned Kislev.
Lies. He led me here.
My voice led you here. I spoke as Ursan, answered when he would not.
What deception is this?
Your fate has been guided by my hand. Skaldan, Kurz, your brother, placed in your way by me. Stones to sharpen you.
Why?
Because gods are selfish. They will betray you as they betrayed me. I have freed you from their burden.
What I did for Ursan.
You did it for yourself. Took what your heart desired. Look. How you've reveled in your dark baptism.
Where is he?
Let me show you what you hold so dear. Tell me, what do you see?
Weakness. A beast unworthy of my faith. Of the blood spilt in his name. The reason Kislev suffers.
Yuri, son of Kislev. Bellacor uses you for his own gain. End this misery. Free me.
You can be greater than Ursan.
Save Kislev.
Take his power. Take his place.
You must, son of Chaos.
I renounce you.
So it begins.
Not die here. Gods of Chaos, I lie here broken, failed by my god, cast out by Bellacor. I have tasted but a morsel of your power. Look at what I have achieved. Let me feast upon it. Kislev will be mine, and together we will serve you. Bestow me with your terrible grace.
It's kind of important to know that before you start any campaign, that those are the direct events leading up to and causing the events of the campaign. Also, it's worth noting the reason that the Demon Prince looks like that as standard. Weirdly, he's not actually the only Demon Prince in the game. There are rogue armies in the game led by Demon Princes, and then there's the Demon Princes you have to fight as part of the the plot. But they're all using, you know, a different customization of the same thing. They're all customized with parts that he can get access to. But the reason that the default model looks like that is because it is specifically based on the generic Demon Prince model from the tabletop, which I didn't know was a thing. I knew Demon Princes were a thing. I didn't know the tabletop had a specific one. Okay, now let's watch these last two. And then I'll just tell you, then we're going to play Cathay. Because I realised I don't really have a reason to play anyone. I don't have a specific reason to play Cathay or, like, to play either Cathay or see each other than I just want to. And someone asked me if I could play Cathay in the Discord. So we're going to do that. But yeah, let's watch these cutscenes. Now this one, I don't think I ever actually watched. This one I think I've skipped over every time it started. Just out of habit, you know? But I think this discusses the origins and motivation of the advisor.
The Tome of Fates. It reveals the secrets of the past, the present, and what may come to be. Most would think me fortunate to own such a book. But I can only use it in service to others. That is my curse. It wakes, tormenting me once more, feeding on the mysteries of this world, unraveling them into opportunity. But opportunity for whom?
That's just kind of explaining, like, why the advisor's here. And I think I think A Broken World is the cutscene that plays when you go to start the campaign. So, actually, there we go. I was wondering where he'd go. Let's actually hit new campaign. I think this will just show that cutscene.
This world has been sundered by a tide of arcane energy. The winds of magic churned into a maelstrom. The Tome of Fate drew me north to find out why. It guided me to a distant fortress steeped in blood. A battle was fought there. Though long over, the spirits still lingered. In the shadow of a broken portal, the trail ended. It was here the Tome conversed with the dead. They told of Ursan, the bear god of Kislev, lost in darkness. A noble prince ventured to save him, yet he strayed from the path and was corrupted by chaos. Savior became executioner. Single shot, bound in faith forsaken, pierced Ursan's heart. And so the bear god roared. The tide that broke the world.
Spirits, where lies Ursan now? Is he here, in the north?
Beyond the maelstrom, in the realm of chaos, in the forge of souls.
Is he alive? What shadow? A demon's?
A master of the dark.
I knew who shackled the bear. Bellacor. Only a fool would challenge Bellacor. And yet, the power of a dying god, there is no greater prize. A mere drop of Ursan's blood would break my curse, ending my servitude to this accursed book. Free to profit from its secrets. But Ursan is locked in the Forge of Souls, deep in the realm of chaos, and I cannot enter this nightmarish domain. All routes have been sealed by the maelstrom. There must be a way. Ah, the tome unveils a spell to summon a portal, one to bypass the maelstrom and create a door into chaos. Knowledge to bargain, for I need an ally, one who is tempted by the power of the Godbear and can withstand the horrors within.
You know, oddly, that last image, you know, of him kind of overlaid on the book is actually, I'm pretty sure, a frame from the ending. I just realized that's him leaving, but they've kind of repurposed it in the beginning in like a single frame to make it look like he's like approaching. But yeah, so that's all the context. I'm going to very quick, just have to alt tab. It might make the game freak out a little bit. But a fucking dumbass fucking bot piece of shit jumped in the chat, and I didn't want to alt tab while the cutscene was playing, so there we go. Hopefully that won't have broken anything. Let's have a look there. Yep, okay, we're good. Let's play Grand Cathay. You know what, I'm gonna change the name of the stream. Yep. Grand Cathay marches to war. Fantasy Dragon China, huzzah. Okay. We're gonna play as Cathay. And we're gonna play as Miao Ying. I will also say that this means I will actually be having to learn Grand Cathay as we're playing, instead of just playing a faction I'm already super familiar with. So please bear with me. I've not played Cathay much. I've played, I think, maybe 10 turns of specifically Xiao Ming. Rather than Miao Ying. Other side, though, Miao Ying will actually place us in fighting Chaos, I believe, because she starts by the Great Bastion, I believe. Whereas Xiao Ming starts further south. Weirdly, he starts in combat with Clan Eshin, as well as, you know, just Cathayan rebels. Yeah. He tends to, from what I have seen of like the map around him, he's like fighting green skins and Skaven rebels and ogres as well, because he also starts right next to the Great Maw, which is actually a thing on the map. The Great Maw is just there; you can go see it. It's gross. It looks like a fucking Sarlacc pit. Yeah. So, yeah. Again, please bear with me about the fact that it's going to be running like shit. There's nothing I can do about it until I get my new graphics card. If it is completely unwatchable, I may, because I can record stuff, but I can't stream stuff. If it turns out to be completely unwatchable, I know I can get decent quality recordings. So if it's completely unwatchable, I will just record. I won't stream this, I'll just record it. In future, if that ends up being the case. But hopefully, the problems we were having with the Kislev campaign were because the Kislev campaign, for reasons I don't understand, ran spectacularly worse for me than Nurgle and my current Ogre Kingdoms campaign. I really don't get it. It's an odd one. Okay, start the campaign. Grand Cathay is the land of the Celestial Dragon Emperor. Before the world was blighted by chaos, the Celestial Dragon learned to take human form. To aid his rule, he took a mate, the Moon Dragon, and they had 9 children who became noble rulers of Cathay's many provinces. Of the 9, 4 have been lost to time and enmity. Miao Ying, the Storm Dragon, was the firstborn, given the honor of ruling the northern provinces and charged with Cathay's defense as commander of the Great Bastion. But the predations of chaos grow, the Bastion is under strain. The power of a god may aid in securing Cathay's borders. Perhaps there is an opportunity to lure the Storm Dragon into the Chaos Realms. This is also another thing. is the amount of attention in terms of the cutscenes they get is different from faction to faction. Because with Cathay, you'll see from the cutscene that the actual intro cutscene for Cathay, because I watched all the cutscenes, could work for either leader, like because they are both present, both Miao Ying and Zhao Ming. I think I got that right. Are both present in the cutscene. Same with the Ogre Kingdoms. You know, both of the legendary lords for the Ogre Kingdoms are in their cutscene. And obviously, you know, Nurgle, Tzeentch, Khorne, Slaanesh, and the Legions of Chaos. They've only got one legendary lord each, so of course there's only one cutscene. And then fucking Kislev rocks in with bespoke cutscenes for all three legendary lords. And it's like, what the fuck? Like, I mean, I'll grant you, the difference between Boris Ersson's cutscene and Kostaltin's cutscene is very slim. It uses a lot of the same assets for both. But it's still kind of fun. Like, I mean, it leads further into my indication, the notion I have that Kislev is kind of like the main character, at least at launch. If there is a main faction at launch, it's Kislev. Okay.
Grand Cathay, a vast empire to the east, ruled by powerful creatures, dragons who can inhabit human form.
You are gravely mistaken. We have no interest in a mere god's power.
No interest in power to use against the forces of chaos?
I am Miao Ying, the Storm Dragon. Older than the gods themselves. You are here for a greater purpose. This map shows the energy of all things. There should be harmony, but the world is unbalanced. My younger sister, Shenzu, bringer of light and hope. She ventured beyond the Norsken Mountains, but was lost. Without her light, darkness prevails, and our family has no comfort.
Though I feel your loss, the Tome of Fates provides no insight to your sister's whereabouts.
Ursa knows he witnessed her fate.
Then why does he not tell you, Iron Dragon?
There is mistrust between dragons and gods.
If we save Ursun, he will tell us how to find Shenzu.
Let me serve you, mighty dragons. I can reach Ursun, lead you to him before it's too late. For one drop of his blood.
Your destiny is to guide us.
The armies of Cathay must breach the maelstrom and march into chaos. Balance will be restored to the world when Shenzu is returned to you.
Pretty cool. Yeah, you can see why people thought that Cathay might have had a Boris Ursus situation with Shenzu. Again, I don't think they do. I'm not completely. I'm pretty sure they don't. I seem to remember that someone from CA went on the Reddit or went in like the public Discord and said we've shown all of them now after like Boris was revealed. But yeah, I'm pretty sure they don't. I am curious as to how they deal with it. But yeah, so there we go.
I am the anointed guardian of the Great Bastion. Any breach brings great dishonor upon me. So prove your worth, mortal.
Yes, Great Matriarch. There is indeed a rupture in the Great Bastion. The forces of Tzeentch
invaded
the ruins of the Snake Gate and have taken the Terracotta Graveyard. Further along, the Bastion remains under threat from the Changer's forces, or, as you know him, the dread power Qianqi. Yet, despite the enemy assaults, There remain brave defenders, ever loyal to you. Bolster them, and they will gladly confederate with a revered dragon. You
will fine
need
so far?
Such
okay,
allies,
good.
For it is on the other side of the wall where the threat is strongest.
Like, it's looking
the
fine for me watching
siege
it.
Continues, for the dark
like
powers
me, like,
are
playing
never
the actual
sated.
Game, but...
And there,
the OBS preview
the orchestrator of this woe, Kairos Fateweaver. Face this demonic oracle, lest he bring down the Bastion. Fateweaver is insidious, and the invasion is only part of his plan. Rebellion festers in Nanyang's minds under the Changer's malign influence. Punishment must be swift to reinforce your authority. Before we can hope to take the fight into the Chaos Realms themselves, we must bring harmony back to Grand Cathay. There is much to do.
I will okay. earn my mother's trust.
Agents of Fateweaver fan the flames of rebellion. We cannot risk such sedition reaching Nangar.
Actually, you know what? I'm gonna... Where the fuck... This is, you know, this is always the fucking problem I have with Warhammers. I never know where to put my fucking... I never know where to put my webcam. I seem to remember it, like, I think I just had it in the middle of the screen for a while. When I played Warhammer 2, or when I was doing a lot of streaming of Warhammer 2. I never know where to put my thing. Cause I'm covering up the advisor's, text, you know? I mean, you can hear him. But then if I, like, put it... Actually, no, I'm gonna put it down here. Again, to try and just save any frames I can, I also have, like, the 2D things.
I will make my father
I'd say cover the map. Oh, that is true, yeah. You don't really need to see... You, like, it doesn't actually affect you guys if you can't see the mini-map. I need to see the mini-map, but you guys don't, so... Let's actually also just make myself a bit smaller there. There we go. There we go. Okay. Yeah, that'll do. Yeah, because then you can still see the world events and stuff, you just can't see the minimap. Big question is, will that
the
fuck me over when
resisted.
I'm on the battlefield? I don't think so. Because I think even on the battlefield, this is just still the minimap. Okay, I want to point out one thing. One thing that I didn't see anyone ever fucking talk about. And I'm going to... There is a... Hang on. I mean, you can't... Yeah, no, you can see it there. The button up there. For the faction. Here. That shows, you know, just the actual, you know, faction overview. Pretty standard faction overview. But, hold on, what's... What's this? Yeah, there's a button to rename your faction manually. It never would have occurred to me as something to ask for. But you can manually change the name of your faction. And if you just hit that, it, like, yeah, returns to normal. It returns to the default. But that's pretty nice. I like that. You know, that'd be good, you know, I mean, because I remember a lot of people complaining about the fact that, you know, if you're playing, say, the Empire in Warhammer 2... the Empire in Warhammer 1, you were just, you know, you started out called the Empire, but then later on they changed it so the default was Reichland. But then if you confederated people, you wouldn't necessarily get called the Empire. But you know, the ability to literally just be able to go in and change it, that's fantastic. Before we even get into the fight, before we even start a battle, there's some shit I'm gonna have to talk about right now. And it's not Cathay specific. It's not Cathay specific. But let's have a quick look at the diplomacy screen. Because this changes how you play the game. Fundamentally. Okay. Looks relatively normal right now. You got quick deal.
Wind
which is
shaper.
Quite nice. Where, you know, quick, you know, but you got quick deal. We'll talk about that in a second, but you got quick deal.
City,
I want to just tell you about something. And you know what? In order to do this, let's look at the Celestial Loyalists. We're not necessarily going to make an agreement with them yet, but let's have a look at the Celestial Loyalists. Let's have a look at how much the diplomacy system has changed. Now, you get told in specific numbers how willing. the enemy, not the enemy, they're not necessarily the enemy, the other, the AI faction is, how willing they are to do what you want them to. You just get told it. And as you select it, you get told that. They've got some leftover goodwill, hit the balance offer button, and boom, it will just show you how much money they're willing to throw in to sweeten the deal. Same the other way around. I don't think I've got something that this guy necessarily, I could necessarily talk this guy into at the moment, but say if I had more money, or say if he didn't necessarily want to have a non-aggression pact. Hang on, who can I? Is there
Celestial,
like any, maybe these ones don't like me that much? Nope, they like me too.
Oh
no, wait, here we go. Military access. We can just hit the balance offer, and boom, that's how much it's going to take for them to agree to this deal in terms of raw currency. That is some nice shit. That is some good shit, my guys. It's great. They've also put a trade settlement button. I believe it has to be settlements that border each other that you can trade, but you can finally trade settlements. Fucking good stuff. But beyond that, more than any of this shit, there's also a threaten button, which I think means you can basically just be like, do this or I'll kill you. I've never had that work as of yet, but that is an option. But beyond that, and I can't necessarily show you it, maybe I can. We don't actually have like explicit allies with anyone.
There is
just yet.
In truly others.
There we go. We'll just make this deal with the Celestial loyalists. But if you have an actual alliance with someone, you can go to the war coordination option, and that'll add all sorts of shit, including the ability to build outposts and stuff. Which, deals with ogres as well. Build outposts and stuff, through which you can gain access to that faction's units into your army, using a separate currency called Allegiance. You can just recruit them to your armies, 4 per army. Pretty fucking good. It's not all of them. I think, depending on the level of the outpost, at first it's only the stuff that they have that they can recruit in that city. And then, hang on a minute. Are we okay? Did the stream just freak the fuck out? I just looked over and it was red. Are we still going? Are we still alive? I just looked over and my stream thing was red. I've got like 486 dropped frames from like the stream just crapping out for a second there. Are we good? I think we're good. I think we're good now, but the stream did not like something just that. But yeah, you can get all sorts of cool shit. At the first level of outpost, it's just what they can recruit from that settlement. And then when you get to like 3, it's anything in their global recruitment. I believe there are some units that are still off limits, but still, it gives you a huge amount of access to a lot of shit. Weirdly, with the Ogre Kingdom specifically, you don't actually even need to be in an alliance with them to recruit their units. If you're near one of their camps, you can just recruit some low-level ogres just by virtue of being nearby, which we don't appear to have the ogre mercenary system that was in Warhammer 2. It appears to have been replaced with, if there happens to be an ogre camp nearby, you can just recruit ogres that way. But yeah, there's just a lot of ways to mix up your armies and to get other armies involved. Also, this is a fucking fascinating one, which I didn't even know was a thing until, like, it took me by surprise in my Kislev campaign, where I randomly found myself, of all things, supporting Nakari's army against vampire counts. If 2 factions that do not have any diplomatic relations, do not actually have an alliance or anything, if they're within reinforcing range of something, and one of them is attacking a mutual enemy, despite them having no diplomacy between each other, you can reinforce that otherwise neutral army because it's attacking a mutual enemy, which is fucking fascinating. That's just a very interesting thing. It makes sense. It's really cool. The diplomacy is so much more interesting and so much cooler. And also, with the fucking war coordination, you can tell, you know, your allies to defend certain settlements, to, you know, go after certain armies, and they actually fucking do it! The AI listens to you, and sends armies out. In my Nurgle campaign, that's more or less how I defended the couple of settlements I had at the arse end of the Mountains of Morn and in the Darklands, was I was allied with a couple of other Nurgle factions and two Skaven factions, Throt the Unclean's faction and Hellpet. And Throt is actually in the game. Some of the Legendary Lords from the earlier games are present leading factions in this one. The ones that I remember off the top of my head are Manfred von Karstein, Manfred von Karstein's leading the Vampire Counts. Karl Franz is leading the Empire. Throt is leading Hellpit. Deathmaster Snitch is leading Clan Eshin. Oddly, despite the fact that Norska's everywhere, you know, there's Norskans all over the place, no Throg or Wulfric. They're not in the game, and there's no Legendary Lords for Chaos either present. Despite the fact that there's Chaos Warriors everywhere as well. But yeah, no, it's you know, they actually listen to you if you tell them to go. So I actually just had, like, Skaven and other allied, like, Nurgle factions defending my southern border, as Nurgle while I was busy, like, you know, conquering through the rest of the Mountains of Morn and trying to basically see off a bunch of fucking Khorne factions that got pissed off at me because they were allied with the Legions of Chaos and I had to go to war with them because I almost lost the campaign. But yeah, the diplomacy in this is so much better. Like, it's so much more fun and it's so much more interesting. The ability to recruit Sunnians. There's some forces that, I'll be honest with you, I can't imagine will get too much use out of the ability to recruit units from other factions. But again, as Nurgle, really useful. As Khorne, who has basically no ranged, and as Slaanesh as well, who has literally no ranged, very useful. As Tzeentch, it'll be quite useful because you don't have a good front line. Honestly, Tzeentch and Nurgle, despite them being enemies, can really help each other out because if you're allied with Tzeentch as Nurgle, you can get some pretty fucking solid ranged units to back you up, to back up your, like, solid but mostly immobile front line. And again, if you're Tzeentch, you can get this really fucking solid, bulky front line for the enemy to break themselves against while you're fucking, you know, your purple horrors, your pink horrors or whatever, just fucking pelting them. The dwarves are going to have it good with the Empire. They're going to be able to get cavalry and shit. Just some good shit. Like, it's so interesting, and I can't wait to see the wild shit that's going to be possible. Trust. By the time Mortal Empires comes out. Just some of the wacky combinations. It's going to be great. It really is. It's going to be great. And it does seem to make Dogs of War seem more likely. Dogs of War, actually, and Nagash. I'll say this. Right, okay. A lot of people have been saying they think Nagash is an unlikely guy to come to Warhammer 3, for the simple reason that his faction would essentially be a combination of the Vampire Coast, the Tomb Kings, and the Vampire Counts. To which I say Demon Prince. To which I can only say Demon Prince. Nagash is going to be the Undead Demon Prince equivalent. Like, his faction, he's going to exist. I guarantee he's going to exist in the world. He's going to be a DLC at some point. And I guarantee he's going to be a combination of those three rosters into one army. The Demon Prince basically paints how he's going to be. I also wouldn't be surprised if Belakor becomes playable in Mortal Empires as a different starting zone for the Demons of Chaos, possibly with zone mechanics. I wouldn't be surprised, however, I'm not necessarily expecting it. Just saying. Okay, let's play the game, shall we? Let's actually have a look at what Miao Ying's got here. Dragon. What's she got? She got Celestial Dragon Crossbow. Wow, you don't have any of the really cool shit, do you? God, Mortal Empires, how big is that map gonna be? Yeah, that's gonna be an interesting one. I mean, from what I understand, I think the basic Realm of Chaos map in this, like this map, is about the same size as Mortal Empires in terms of sheer number of provinces. Yeah, I don't know, man. I don't know. I don't think it's gonna be as direct a, like, importing of Warhammer's 1 and 2 into Warhammer 3 as the Mortal Empires map in Warhammer 2 was, where it was literally a smaller version of the Warhammer 2 map glued on top of a direct translation of Warhammer 1's map. For the simple reason that we've got large chunks of Warhammer 1's map completely redesigned in this version. So I reckon it's going to be a... And honestly, just art style-wise, they're going to have to redesign the whole fucking thing. So I don't know. I don't know what to expect. Immortal Empires. I really don't. Okay. Oh, God. I'm talking so much, my throat's getting dry here. Okay. Let's just build a corral there. Worry about this later. Let's go fight this guy and see what Miao Ying is like in battle. I will also say, there's so many just nice little things that I was not expecting coming into Warhammer 3. We might hear it now, we might not. I don't know how consistent it is, but quite frequently, I noticed that at least legendary lords, do speeches before, small speeches before battles, like, the generals used to in older games. I know that Katarin does it a lot. I've heard Scrag do it a few times. Now that I've been listening out for it, and I dimly recall, what's-his-dick, the other Cathayan lord, when I briefly played him, doing it as well. Yeah, it's really interesting. It's really fun. Okay. Okay, just channel magic. Magic system's different. I don't really understand it, but, it's different. Okay, let's actually have a quick look here, because I've not actually looked at these guys too much. We do have one of the really cool things, that we've got the, Sky Junk, which, if memory serves, I think this is the one that's basically a mobile artillery platform,
Wing
isn't it?
Band of fire.
Yeah, look at that range. That's a mobile artillery platform, if ever I've seen one. Buckaroos. We've got this, good lady here.
For the Emperor!
It's odd to me that we can't set her to start in dragon form, but that we have to actually turn her into dragon form during the fight. We got our peasant archers, we've got our jade warriors, and we've got some peasant dudes. And then, of course, we've got the celestial dragon crossbowman. Again, if you're just looking at the human units of Cathay, you could very easily be convinced into thinking it was like Three Kingdoms 2 or something. Maybe a bit more cartoonish than Three Kingdoms, but not that much. It's only when you turn around and then Sky Junk, and then fucking this bitch with the white eyes, and I think some of her animations involve her literally flying. It's only then that you start realizing that maybe you're not in Kansas anymore. And we do have the yin-yang system here. I don't...
Dragon Gar!
Okay, there we go. Yeah, okay, so that's what the augments do. Okay, it does actually specifically tell you. I wasn't sure. And I think they only get the augment when they're actually like nearby. This is kind of one of the gimmicks of these guys. Also, actually, I'm gonna tell you one thing I'm gonna do right now. I'm gonna turn off formation attack. Because formation attack, I haven't seen that button on any other fucking faction. But when I tried to play as Cathay, that fucking button ruined my life. That button seems to fuck the pathing, especially in settlement battles. Because they try to keep moving as blocks, and it just seems to make their pathing panic half the time. So we're going to turn that off. Is that also anti-large? Yeah, okay. So we'll put the... Actually, you know what? We'll put the... A celestial board. No. No, charge defense against the side. They don't even have any cavalry, but if they did, you want the charge defense on the sides, not in the center.
Long spears!
Ready to defend!
And pop her in there.
For the defense!
But yeah, you for you. And then we put these fellas over here.
Stand together.
We'll put the peasant horseman. Oh, we've got like cute little is that terraced farming? Is that what that is? Like for the rice farms and stuff? The little Chinese lanterns. Good stuff, 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 good stuff. Cathay is a really... This is a part of the map I've not really touched. As of yet. Like, I've not really explored the map. I've not seen too much of Cathay's... Shit. Even on low settings, this game's really fucking pretty. Like, yeah, even though I'm having to play it, like, on really fucking gimp settings, the game is really pretty. It's just super, super fucking pretty. Yeah, let's do that. You've just got long spearmen. So I'll just march these fellas up as well.
I embody the Emperor's will. Serve me.
Okay, so
him.
That's a flying hellstorm battery. Victory. If ever I've seen one. What do you actually have magic wise? Do you have anything that would be more immediately impressive than being able to turn into a dragon? I'm feeling like nah. Earthblood, Storm of Shadows. No, you've got some debuffs. You're getting turned into a dragon quite quickly. Like as soon as I'm able, I'm turning you into a dragon. I want to see you turn into a dragon.
Peasant spearmen!
Defenders of Cathay!
Jade Warriors!
Dragon Guard!
But yeah, I haven't really seen Cathay stuff, but this game, even on low settings, just the art design of the game is absolutely incredible. It is a genuinely beautiful game. Just astonishing, especially when you're getting into like the realms of chaos and that kind of thing. It's pretty fantastic. Why would you ever not be a dragon? There is actually a very good reason to not be a dragon in this, because I get what you mean. Like, why would you ever choose to not be a dragon? And that is, at the very least, for Miao Ying, I think it's less so with Zhao Ming, because he's kind of more of an immediately tough customer, I believe, than Miao Ying, who I think does lean a bit more heavily towards being a caster by default. The dragon form does not have access to all of the same... It just doesn't have access to the same, they just don't have the same access to their spells. Case in point, we just don't have spells, or even her ability as a dragon. The dragons are obviously, like, powerful, melee, situations, but they're not, they're just not as tough. They're just not as, like, magically powerful, as their human form, unfortunately.
The Celestial Daughter!
Stone and steel! Lost in harmony!
Yeah, we're just gonna get our guys there, and,
Shenyang's faithful!
Okay, we haven't even... We barely made contact with the enemy, and their entire army's running away. I mean, it's not... ideal for them. I think the only one in their army that isn't currently in some kind of fleeing is their general. Although their general is losing decisively. There we go, okay. Yeah, okay, well, we ever so slightly wrecked their shit. Just a little bit, just a smidge wrecked their shit. Again, we had a flying artillery battery, a lot more men, and a dragon. So, and also, like, I don't know this for a fact. I'm not, like, super familiar with Cathay's, unit roster. But I believe the Celestial Warrior guys, I think, might be their, like, top-tier infantry. If I were to guess. So yeah, it's not great. What we got here? We can ransom them. We can venerate the ancestors, or we can do the one I don't think I have ever taken in my life, in all of the time I've played all three of the Warhammer, I don't think I have ever taken the leadership option when it's been present, because fucking why would I?
A potent ally has joined your ranks.
And we've got. Thank you.
Embed them in your army.
And we've got
more
our...
levels infest the mines ahead. Bolster your...
Shut up. We got our first hero, the Astromancer. I believe, what magic are you? Are you high magic? Law of Heavens. Yeah, Heavens magic. I believe that in Cathay the magic is, whatchamacallit, gender-based, I think? And I also, I can't remember, hang on. What? Yeah, because you've got alchemists who I think can use, metal? The law of metal, and astromancers, yeah, who can use heavens, so celestial magic. And then we've got our actual lords, where we have, I think, yeah, the law of yin and the law of yang. Are they the only ones that can use the law of yin and yang? Huh. Okay, that's a bit odd. I would have thought that you would have been able to get someone who could do that. Some kind of hero who could do that. Are you law of yin? Yeah, you're the law of yin. Actually, you're a lot of shit, actually. Life Bloom, Storm of Shadows. What the fuck is Storm of Shadows? What school is that? I don't fucking know. Missile Mirror. I think this is yin. Yeah, I think this is yin. Rebirth Talents. Yeah, that's a lot of yin. And Missile Mirror, which, much to my surprise, I saw a video. I haven't seen this in action, personally, but I was quite surprised to find that this is literal. a lot of people I'd seen before, you know, the bigger content creators started getting access to the game, being able to show stuff, had assumed that, like, that the missile mirror would be something that, like, maybe you cast on the enemy and it just, like, stops them from firing and hurts them. Or it gives, like, missile resist or something. Yeah, something like that. No, it's literal. And the amount of damage they take is directly related to how much damage the unit does. Which means, actually, this fucks up Tzeentch. This fucks up Tzeentch so hard, from what I've seen. The blue and pink horrors cannot deal with Missile Mirror, from what I've seen. It messes them up, but good. No, we can't quite reach there. So what I'm actually gonna do is I'm gonna get some gunners. Why? Because I can. Because Ethan can. And here we immediately have the old yin and yang thing, where you have to try and balance yin and yang, and if you are able to balance yin and yang, you get big harmony buffs. We are currently very heavy, it seems, into the yin. Because that's the one that, because that's the harmony that Miao Ying represents. Because yes, the lords, I believe, do specifically kind of tend things towards yin and yang. Yeah, you can see that each of them does lead towards yin or yang. Though it seems to be very definite with the dragon-blooded Shugengan wizards. Which I guess makes sense. They're literally casting yin and yang, but the Lord Magistrate appears to be... you do actually specifically get two with yin and two with yang. Okay. I wonder if that extends to... do the heroes produce yin and yang? Chosen daughter. No, it doesn't seem like they do. Ah! Caravans! Okay, caravans! I thought you wouldn't see caravans on the map. You do see caravans on the map, and if you're not Cathay, you could just fucking attack caravans. I don't know if there's a good reason to. I feel like attacking caravans should be more valuable than attacking normal units, normal armies, but you can make a caravan, we can send it where the fuck ever we want. I have been led to understand that one of the good places to send it early on is Castle Drakenhof, because you can get quite a good sword from Castle Drakenhof. You send it there. The lords actually are consistent. They level up like normal generals. However, you can't ever directly control them. However, it's also worth knowing their armies remain consistent, and as they travel around, they can get all sorts of wild units recruited into their armies, including, I think I saw a post about how they can bafflingly get high elf like gate guards. You know, the high elf gate guard units that are unique to the gates of Ulthuan, somehow they can end up in caravans. But yeah, so we're gonna just dispatch that right off the gate. And yeah, there he is. He's on the map. As I said, you can't control him. They just move towards their objective as the mission goes on. As the mission goes on. Again, I don't even know how like present they are in terms of like enemy factions you're at war with. That's something else I don't know. I don't know if, say, I'm at war with Nurgle, and this goes, like, past the Nurgle army. I don't know if the Nurgle army will attack it. I don't think it will, because I don't know. So you have those scary wandering armies as your own, basically. Yeah, except they don't do anything. Because you can't control them. They just move towards their destination. And then, I don't even know if they're still on the map, but they do come back. But I think they might just vanish.
The rebels claim the mine.
Yes, yes, let's go claim the mines. Defender. Okay. Do I want... You know what? Just because I should probably show off the minor settlement battles. Let's fight this battle as well. There is some peculiarities with the audio. We were actually specifically warned about this. There are some peculiarities with the audio. I will note that at least on my end, again, I don't know how well that it's going to translate into streams. It seems to translate well into the recordings. That, at the very least, as playing it as an experience, the game, when not playing as Kislev, the game has been running a lot better. I don't know if that's, like, the build I've got has been updated. I don't think it has, but it's just been running better. Also, I will once again say that I am expecting that the performance of the game will be better for me when the game actually comes out, because, you know, it took me a long time to learn this lesson, but drivers, updated drivers can actually fucking do a lot. Especially when I'm in, like, this specific part where I can get the game to run decently well for myself. It's just a matter of, like, trying to get it to run better. You know what I'm saying. But yeah. I have also been kind of avoiding the minor settlement battles. They're not bad. They're a lot better... are the sieges the biggest thing I've heard everyone talking about that they seem to fix? This isn't even a siege. The sieges are a lot better. Although, they do have their own issues still. I think it's kind of impossible to make a perfect siege for the simple reason that everyone wants different shit. The settlement battles, if you're not already familiar, rather than doing what they did in Total War Warhammer 1 and 2, where you just kind of fought on a normal field battle with a settlement in the background, in this one, yeah, you're actually fighting in a minor settlement. Doesn't have any walls or any gates. And no walls that you can actively destroy. It just kind of has choke points surrounding the outside that you have to move in through. The AI, or the defenders, have access to these supply locations that will produce defensive supplies that they can use to block off. I don't know where the build locations are on this map, but where they can erect temporary defenses, such as towers and blockades that you have to either, you know, destroy or avoid. I'm mixed on them, if I'm honest. I'm very mixed on them. I never really... as an attacker, I don't really know how to approach them. I don't know. It's better than there not being anything there. Yeah, it's a bit odd. At times, I wish I did have more of an option. Here, pathfinding hell, from what you're saying. A little bit. Again, actually, with Cathay specifically, pathfinding sucks again. But I think, I'm hoping we should be easy if we turn our formation attack. Because it's them sticking it to formation, I think, which fucks the pathfinding for them. Okay.
Defenders of Cathay!
Okay, well. Again, this is the thing. I don't know if we should commit all of our forces to, like, one big frontal assault, or if we should come in from two directions. You know what? I'm gonna try my luck. We're gonna come in from two directions, and we're gonna hopefully kind of move towards this defensive point. It is very rare, in my experience, that capturing the actual defensive points becomes important, to be brutally honest. for the simple reason that generally the enemy seems to deploy in reaction to where you deploy, and the enemy will move towards you if they deem it necessary. Okay. Our vanguard horseman is gonna, our like, peasant horseman is gonna be of let's say mixed usefulness here.
Never,
not super useful. There is something to be said about keeping your wizards together. I believe that that actually has an impact on how they are able to perform. However, I'm not going to be doing that today. Mostly because I'm probably going to turn Miao Ying directly into a dragon as soon as we get the option to, again. Because why wouldn't I? If I have the option to turn a bitch into a dragon, why wouldn't I turn a bitch into a dragon? So, yeah, we're going to do that. I'm also going to just put these gunners. Actually, yeah, I'm going to put these gunners here just in case the enemy tries to run out. And we'll put Miao Ying back here.
The storm wind blows.
I don't think the enemy's going to try and run out, but it should, you know, give us something that we can use to fuck the enemy up initially. And we will slowly march these guys up, and we're going to basically just ignore the,
The power of a dragon and the might of Nankao, we can only prevail.
There you go. You heard that, right? Little bit of a speech. It's not a full speech, but every now and again, the legendary lords do say a few words at the beginning of battles. It's not like the full-on speeches that you used to get in, like, Medieval 2. But it's something. It's more than there used to be, you know? And, okay, it does look like there's Jade Warrior Crossbowmen coming out. Quick question. Are the Cathay Dragons the only ones that can turn human, or can the others too? I forget. As far as I'm aware, it's unique to the Cathay Dragons.
For the defense.
The problem is that, honestly, Cathay, while Cathay kind of existed, in the lore originally, not really, you know, it's a,
Store and steel.
You know, while Cathay did sort of exist, in the lore, it didn't, really, it was just kind of vaguely mentioned. And I'll tell you this for free. I'll give you this for nothing. The version of Cathay that now exists in Total War Warhammer 3 is not something that was at all present in the original game. Cathay is basically brand new. Like, it's all brand new lore. So it's kind of hard to say. But I, as far as I can recall, I believe the dragons that are the children of the Dragon Emperor and the Celestial Dragon Emperor
Warriors.
Are unique Whatever in their ability to turn into humans. I don't even honestly know how much they are the same thing as the dragons we've seen elsewhere in Warhammer. I don't know. Like, because they certainly don't fucking look like them, do they?
Ready to defend. Gaiwan's Fury.
There we go. They certainly don't look like normal dragons. From what I heard, Games Workshop basically gave them free range to remake Cathay. Well, not quite. From what I understand, while it's not been officially confirmed, Games Workshop did work with Creative Assembly on this, the modern interpretation of Cathay. On this new version of Cathay. There's the fucking audio breaking again. That happens so much specifically in settlement battles. It's something that I have specifically been told is a known issue that is likely to be, like, if not completely eradicated, cleaned up a lot by release. But I think it's specifically an issue with, I think it's specifically an issue with, like, when the game's, like, taxing your hardware. Is when it starts doing that.
The heavens ask it.
And it is, yeah, it's very specifically when I'm moving the camera as well, isn't it? Yeah, I haven't noticed that as much, but that is something I am aware is like a noted problem. They over there. Ah. Okay, I'll give you this one for free. It's quite clear just from this battle that turning off the fighting formation has drastically improved the pathfinding, but hasn't exactly saved it. The audio's cursed. Yeah, I know. Oh, that's another nice thing, actually. When you're casting spells, the game automatically slows down, so you can target better. Hang on. I want to be a bit of a cheeky bastard. Let's see if we can't reform fully here. Quite pleasant if we could. Yeah, we got that fucking thing up there. Ah, their leader's an astromancer.
Defend the realm. Order and balance.
Okay.
Celestial fury. The heavens unleashed.
The storm unleashed.
Let's go fuck that guy up. Bunch of peasants versus dragons seems like a fair fight. Yeah, it is a fair fight. It's 100% a fair fight. See, look, these guys are fighting peasants. I mean, they're also fighting, you know, the trained soldiery, but there's some peasants there. Are you okay? How are you doing? I genuinely can't tell.
Ready.
Oh, whoops. Okay, no, he's being attacked by peasant horsemen. Okay, let's dragon, please hurt the peasant horseman. I think this guy is base. I think, if I remember correctly, I think, honestly, I just think that, okay, he's actually just being knocked around by Miao Yang. Is what's happening to him.
Wind and fire. For Cathay.
Yeah, if memory serves, I think the heroes of this,
I hear the heavens.
Of Cathay, I think they basically look like they're doing, like, airbending and shit. Yeah, like the astromancers and alchemists fighting with what appears to be, for all intents and purposes, like, Avatar the Last Airbender on some, it seemed to be on some Avatar the Last Airbender shit, those guys.
Strike them down.
Now, these guys, I'm amazed, are willing to run. Aren't willing to run immediately. And honestly, to be even more bluntly honest about it, the fact that they're even willing to try to fight Miao Ying is kind of wild. Like, I get that these guys are in open rebellion, but at the very least, the peasants, I seem to recall that the dragons, understand the law, the dragons are understood to essentially be gods. They're not literally gods, but they
in terms of socially, that's the function they serve, is they function like gods. So yeah. Yeah, there we go. We fought a settlement battle. I'm bad at them. The settlement battles are easier once you actually understand how to play your individual faction. I got a lot better at the settlement battles as Nurgle, but then again, almost Nurgle seems like he's almost designed to be decent at the settlement battles. Because Nurgle, well, you know, he's a green tide. Yeah, okay, no, that's orcs, but he's, you know, a pus green tide, where he just kind of marches lumberingly forward towards the enemy. Yeah, like he just goes, and like he will eventually overrun the enemy. He doesn't need to be quick. So the fact that the settlement battles, at least in what I've seen, turn into a series of skirmishes, while you're gradually kind of chasing the enemy into the city, just assuming you're winning, makes this a lot better. I will not loot.
Make a watchtower.
Looting feels out of character.
Only Nanli remains in the hands of the rebel lords.
For a fancy dragon, you know, feels a little bit feels a spot unlikely.
Miao Ying, the majestic defender.
Is this Miao Ying? Yeah, it's Miao Ying. Okay. Yeah, let's lean into being a spellcaster.
The bastion's defense requires it.
Yeah, let's lean heavy into that, and actually, yeah, we'll lean into him as well. We might end up actually getting rid of this guy. I'm sat here desperately trying to remember the name of the leader of the Yellow Turbans. Hang on. Leader of the Yellow Turbans.
Zhang Ju, according to Encyclopedia Britannica, led by Zhang Ju, a Taoist faith healer who had gained numerous adherents during a widespread pestilence, the rebellion was directed against the tyrannical eunuchs who dominated them.
Okay, I was specifically looking for the guy who leads them in Dynasty Warriors, which was Zhang Zhao, Zhang Bao, and Zhang Liang. So we'll just call this guy, you know what, he's not leading his own army. He's Zhang Liang. He's not doing his own shit. He's working for someone else. He's not Zhang Xiao, he's Zhang Liang. Okay.
The Emperor's chosen daughter.
We're back and get a drink. Okay. I'm not gonna lie, we're coming up to the end of this stream, because I was at work and I did have to walk home, so I am quite tired. So we're not gonna get, like, crazy far.
You are the defender of Cathay's northern border, yet the forces of Tinch have broken through the Snake Gate and befouled Cathay's interior.
Yes, I know. We have to restore the Great Bastion. Oh, boy. The Great Bastion is gonna be... Again, that's a mechanic I did not get anywhere near when I did briefly try to play Cathay before, because I was playing as the other guy.
Ready to defend.
Jiminy Cricket. Witness. I was playing as Jiminy Cricket. Let's take that Pyrrhic victory. I'm not fighting another minor settlement battle this quickly. We'll just occupy that. And I think, has that wiped out that rebel faction? Yes, the rebel lords of Nanyang have been wiped out. We have our first province, and they've got a spice market, which is giving us too much fucking yin! Need to get some yang in here. There we go, let's get some yang in here. Yang it up! Let's get that fucking yang going! Growth 1. Good, because we need to actually get a basic infantry recruiting building at some point. Because, you know. You always need this shit. And missile mirror. Thank you.
Celestial father would approve.
You always need missile mirror. And let's have a look here. We got Dragon's Edict. Well, oh no, it's a bunch of it. Okay, we've got the Trade Dragon's Edict, the Iron Dragon's Edict, which I think is our brother. The Storm Dragon's Edict, which is us. The Fire Dragon's Edict, which we don't know of, and the Sea Dragon. Yeah, we don't know about 1, 2, 3, 4 of these. But we know about these two. Okay, let's go with... You know what? Let's go with control until... Because, yeah, we did just kill a bunch of people. Let's go with control. Get this place back under wraps. Damn, Cathay's small. I knew people mentioned this before. I didn't realize it was this small because fucking what's his... I mean, we can't see it because it's in the fog of war, but that's the Great Maw right there. Which means that, like, our brother is, like, just here. Like, he's just... Yeah, like, he's literally just around here, I think. Yeah. Why can we see... Oh, we can see all the way over here because that's where our caravan is. Okay. I guess now we immediately have to kind of turn north and try and clear out the terracotta graveyard. Yeah, get a lot of money. That's one thing I do recall about Cathay is that Cathay apparently, from what I've heard, has just an incredibly good economy. Like, they are just economy out the wazoo. Which, again, I think might be one of the things that makes them a relatively easy starting faction. Even though they're not a recommended start. Just because, you know, if you're rich, you can do a lot of shit, you know? It's a lot easier than being, say, Nurgle and struggling to... And, like, constantly finding yourself, like, struggling to maintain fucking anything. Oh, and, of course, we got our... Wujing Compass. I don't even... Okay, wait. The Wujing Compass answers the winds of magic to bring prosperity to Grand Cathay. Direct the compass fills the respective energy reserve. The greater the energy reserve, the larger the benefits are. Of the energy reserve of all directions will decay over time. Ah, okay. I understand. Let's go with the Dragon Emperor's Wrath. Actually, no. Let's go with the Celestial Lake. Yeah. Income at all buildings. Chances of... Yeah. Set that going that way. Again, just selecting buffs. That is one thing that, again, Creative Assembly seems to have... a lesson Creative Assembly seems to have learned. Which is...
Are you worthy?
Which is, they learned... I mean, they've learned this, like, partway through fucking Warhammer 2, but they realized that rather than differentiating factions by making the base game faction suck at some things, or, like, you know, they operate more by making certain factions great at things rather than making everyone shit at things and some guys okay at things, which is generally just a much better feeling than the other way around. Okay. How are we doing here? Still yin. All yin in this motherfucker. Let's get that jade stance.
We must remain superior.
Let's chill that jade stance out. And you know what? We're gonna keep our... Who the fuck? Who fucking dares? Kurgan Warband. All right, come here. No, come here. No, I'm being real. Fucking come here.
We shall resist.
Thank you. I'm just gonna quickly venerate my you know, the honored ancestors. Get a quick veneration
Serve
in.
The Emperor.
And then
None
I'm gonna get some more peasants here, because I still don't actually have the means to recruit more of them. But I'm gonna, you know, a more proper infantry. But oh boy, you're gonna be in trouble. Don't you dare, Temptress. I'm fucking seeing you over there, you little chicken piece of shit. You chicken little motherfucker. Don't you dare. Yeah, thanks. I was going to come for you in a minute anyway, but I mean, it helps if you come for me. That, proves quite a bit. Ah, here we go. Okay. Yep, here it is. Here it is. Here it is. These are some of the, yeah, you do occasionally get, situations that emerge with the caravans. A lot of the time it's just them being attacked by ogres. And here we got, yeah. There's a stench on the air, the unmistakable aroma of cooking bones. A band of ogres burst forth, jewel dripping from their mouths. They look on hungrily at your retinue. The leader shouts out his demand. They'll let you pass if they can eat some of your meat. And they don't mean the cargo in the caravan. We can either feed them peasant archers and actually get some benefits to the blood guzzlers, or we can fight them. And you know what? I can't show you an Ogre Kingdom's campaign, but I don't think Creative Assembly can get mad at me for fighting against the Ogre Kingdoms when they're all over the map. So let's just, let's fight the Ogre King. I mean, the Ogre Kingdoms are going to be there even if you don't have them, you know? That's how the game works. Also, I have never seen a faction be quite so transparently just a placeholder as the orcs that are in the Darklands right now. Like, there are settlements in the Darklands in this game right now called, like, the Gates of Zar, Zar Nagrund. You know, like, they're just the big named Chaos Dwarf settlements. And who holds them? Why, it's some greenskins. What's their faction called? Darklands orcs. I've never seen it more obvious that they're just waiting to get replaced by Chaos Dwarves. I would almost be willing to put money on the Chaos Dwarves being one of, if not the first, DLC for the game. Obviously not including the Ogre Kingdoms. Also, the fact that we get attacked by the Ogre Kingdoms is 100% why the standard... like army you start with as this guy as a caravan is has quite so many spears in it.
Mines as one.
And yeah, we've got a lot of cannons. You know what? Let's get our cannons. Let's get our cannons all the way back here.
The personification of law.
Cannons.
And you know what?
Subordinate only to dragons!
There we go. Okay. The ogres are going to come at us from over there. The ogres are also going to eat some hot shit from some grand cannons.
Move in harmony! And we shall prevail!
Hey, even our fucking Lord Magistrate, generic leader, here, even he just had a little speech there. Also, I will say, I do like how, let's pause this here. How casually he stood. Like, he's not stood in a ready position. I wonder if he looks more ready when the enemy's, like, right there. But it almost... I mean, there's no fucking scabbard, but it looks like he's stood as if his sword's... As if he's resting his hand on a sword in a scabbard. Also, I don't know why he's fat. Are all the Lord Magistrates fat? Hmm. Yeah, we got the Ogre Kingdoms over here. Let's just go have a quick look at them. I mean, is there any surprise? I mean, what are we even fighting ogre-wise? Hang on. Is it just man-eaters? I think it might just be man-eaters, a leader, and then Noblars and the fucking saber tusks. Yeah. I mean, there's no surprises with the man-eaters, is there? They're literally just the man-eater models from Warhammer 2. Again, that's transparently what they were doing with the ogre mercenary stuff, just giving you a taste of the ogre kingdoms. The ogre kingdoms have got some really cool-looking units. I don't so much like the Slaughtermaster Lord, but the, although he does have the fun little missing foot, but the Butcher Lord, the Butcher Hero has some cool stuff. Got you, our Noblars there. Clearly using the same animations as goblins, but with very distinct models. They're a very fun looking faction. And I'm not going to go into any details, not allowed to, but I, what I've played of them, the Ogre Kingdoms are quite fun. I've played, you know, a couple of hours as the Ogre Kingdoms, and they are quite fun. Although it is weird, because, you know, you're used to seeing, you know, big stompy things as, like, really tough. But for balance reasons, like, standard Ogre Bulls aren't all that tough. Wait, what the fuck spells that? Flock of Doom, yeah, okay. Yeah, because it's a Slaughter Master. Oh, it's Law of Beasts, the Slaughter Master. Oh, goddammit, I had these guys set on skirmish. They don't need to skirmish. Also, from I think these cannons are quite quick for artillery. Yeah. Especially, again, they're attached to oxen. So I think they're not actually... Yeah, they're about the same speed as the infantry. The I think that's the case for a lot of Cathay's artillery, actually.
Peasant spearmen!
Thoughts in harmony!
Shenyan's faithful! Warriors!
All to command!
Okay, yeah, this is the problem. The saber tusks are trying to go for the cannon crews here. Hang on.
Move in formation.
Never conquered. Archers,
march in ordered ranks,
guided by ancestors.
Stone and steel.
Defenders of Cathay.
Actually, you know, let's just drop those engines. Try and get the crews out of here. Leave the cows. The ogres can eat the cows. I don't care.
Bunch of scaredy cats. The dragons chose me.
Where's their leader? Oh, their leader's running off. Okay. Okay, well, let's turn the magistrate round and have him go beat up the ogres. Also, because I'm curious as to how he fights. Like, what his animations look like. Are they running off now as well? No? What are you doing?
Cut them down!
Fingers of Cathay!
Okay, shit. Our cannon crews are getting quite badly mulched. You know what? Turn off formation. Formation attack, I swear to God, is like the most obnoxious thing. I think the ogres would be up there with some of the most frightening things to deal with if you lost. Yeah, it wouldn't be great for you. I mean, you've heard the song, right? From the Ogre King's trailer? Specifically describing their struggling treats. Like, they enjoy... Like, they specifically seem to enjoy eating things that are alive and trying to fight back. They're pretty fucked up. Especially for being such like otherwise not necessarily like light-hearted, but relatively otherwise presented as like kind of light-hearted unit, like characters. I'd almost put them as like more grim orcs, like, cause they're more obviously dark than the orcs are, but they're kind of a similar tone of the orcs, but if the orcs leaned a bit further into the horror elements of them, rather than the humor of them. You know what? Let's actually have a quick look at our units here. Let's get all of our guys lined up. Because if I remember correctly, I think the orcs are like comical until you thought about how fucked everything is from. Yeah. For the orcs, a big part of their appeal is how comic they are. Whereas the ogres, that seems to be less of a concern. But yeah, let's have a quick look at our guys here, because I think.
Order and balance.
Warriors!
Yeah, I think Kislev and Cathay. Also, you can see how much better the battle maps run compared to the campaign map. It's kind of nuts. But don't worry, when I get my new graphics card in March, it will run even better. It'll be silky smooth. But yeah, I think, God, it's going to be hard to tell on these guys, huh?
Praise the dragons!
But I believe that Cathay. I think Cathay and Kislev, though I remember hearing it, but I don't remember seeing it too much in the actual units here. I believe have mixed gender units.
Because that,
That's clearly a female
Order
officer line,
balance.
Lack of a term, a female unit bark. I guess, actually, you know what the thing is with the Jade Warriors? Can you tell the difference? Is the... I mean, some of them look a bit smaller than the others, but that's about it. Also, oh my god, look at that dude in the middle's face when I'm just a little bit out. Oh my god.
Oh my god.
Is it just the Jade Warriors that are like mixed? It certainly seems that way.
Wind and fire!
Raise the dragons!
Long spears!
Praise the dragons!
Yeah, because these are all female. I think I know what's going on here. The Jade Warriors are mixed. Because it doesn't make any effect on how they look aesthetically. They still look like... They're all just going to look like turtle people, regardless because of how heavy their armor is. But then I think the rest of them aren't like mixed in the unit. But there are plenty of women, of like female units in the Cathay army. I think it seems to be. I think, especially from the trailers, a lot of gunpowder units, use female soldiers in Cathay for some reason. I do definitely remember that being a thing for Kislev as well, having like female like standard soldiers, but
the Storm Dragon.
I can't like specifically
Footsteps
remember.
In harmony.
Oh well, and let's just quickly fix up the Great Bastion there. There we go, let's just try to fix it, the snake. Oh wow, it actually generates income. I honest to god did not expect that to actually generate income. That has actually surprised me.
The Storm Dragon.
Okay. Yeah, we'll upgrade this. Get fleshed stone.
A tool fit for the dragon's daughter.
Let's get Curse of the Midnight Wind. And oh, this is for our caravan master. I guess caravan master is like essentially a unique variant on the Lord Magistrate. I mean, that wouldn't be the only example of that in the game, actually, because the Kislev has a similar thing, where they've got the Atamans, which are specific kinds of Kislevite lords that you have like a separate selection of Atamans that you can basically put in charge of provinces when you take them. But I think you have a hard limit of how many Atamans you can have. I think it's you get one Ataman for every two provinces you own. But the Atamans, despite in all ways, like, looking and behaving like Boyars, which is the standard melee generals for Kislev, they're unique to being Atamans. You can actually put them in charge of armies, but then they lose, then they're no longer functioning as an Ataman at that point. I think you can then put them back as an Ataman after the fact. Interestingly, when you're playing as an Ataman, when you're using an Ataman, they do actually occasionally have decisions to make. Sometimes it's just, you know, which, like, faction benefit do you want out of two? But, in a lot of cases, it'll be, do you want to upgrade this guy so he is better in battle? So it's almost like you're training a melee lord, like a melee general, or do you want him to be a better, like, provincial governor? Oh, we can actually... yeah, okay, but unlike the Atamans, these guys seem to have their own... They've got their own shit. okay. Yeah, right. Let's go with... Lower the chance of ambush.
An upper hand, indeed.
Where the fuck are you? Oh, he's in the Darklands. Yeah, the Blasted Wastes. Yeah, and up here, Demonstone, the Howling Wastes. And he can't see it, but Tsar Nagrund is literally right here. And yeah, you see? Darkland Orcs. See what I'm telling you? Literally just called the Darklands, the Darkland Orcs. I genuinely would not be surprised if the Chaos Dwarf... I can't remember what the first DLC for Warhammer 2 was. Was it? Was it a, if it was... If it was the Tomb Kings, I'd be willing to put money on the first Storm DLC Dragon. At all for this being them fellas. Let's go with the Bastion Patrolled. But yeah, if it was the Tomb Kings with the first DLC for Warhammer 2, I'd be willing to bet Chaos Dwarves as first DLC for Warhammer 3. Is that killing anything I can't replace? I'll be able to replace
Stand
the J-Warriors in a minute.
Evil.
It's fine.
We must break their spirits.
And what's this? Cavern encountered the shortcut. Your guides know of a route less travel that is safer and quicker, but precious information will not be cheap to obtain. A small share of the caravan's profits. Yeah, that's a great deal. Box of Delights. A wild-eyed alchemist. Oh, this is the thing about fucking... This is the thing about snorting fucking warp dust, isn't it? A wild-eyed alchemist proudly presents you with an ornate chest, which seems to vacillate in and out of corporeality. He declares that it contains purest magic, distilled from several tons of warp stone and purged of all corruption. His experiment, alas, is unrepeatable, so this boon must be used wisely. Execute the alchemist, not great. Add it to the water supply! Add it to the water supply! I mean, we're doing that one because we're still leaning towards yin. So yeah, let's stuff fucking warpstone in the water supply. Whatever.
In unsettled times, it pays to maintain harmony amongst the competing forces of nature.
Yep. Okay. Add growth to the bastion so we can actually improve it. Drink the warp stone. Drink the warp. Consume the warp. Consume the cum chalice. No. Don't know why that reference sprung to mind, but there you go.
The Emperor's chosen.
The primal balance.
Okay, yeah, restore the balance of harmony. I get it. I get it. Trust me, I get it. Trust me, I get
the
it.
Celestial.
Okay. You know what? Let's also no. Here's what we do. Okay, we go flesh to stone. We get evasion. Then we get talons of night, and then we start leveling her as a melee lord.
The bastion's defense requires.
That's what we do because she's got a fancy set of abilities that Ethan want. Ethan want fancy fight. Thank you. Ethan want fight. Fancy fight. Yes, please. Fancy fight, magic woman. Thank you. Yes.
My lord, a rival power desires a change in your mutual relations.
Okay. Imperial wardens. All right. Okay. But how about military access? How about on top of military access, we get a trade agreement going? And how about on top of all that? You give me some money! Again, diplomacy. Fucking It doesn't... seem like the biggest shit in the world, but I'm being fucking serious. The diplomacy changes are like... are incredible. They are like the... Like, beyond, like, the new races, obviously, the diplomacy changes, like, the biggest game changes in Warhammer 3, if you ask me. Hold on, the Great Bastion is broken, a high-ranked dragon is missing, and Chaos is going nuts. Where the heck is the Emperor of Cathay? Hang on, I think where he is on the map somewhere. I can't remember where his city is. But I believe there is literally, I think the capital of Cathay. Yeah, there he is. He's in there. He's floating above Wei Jin.
Never conquered, never broken.
He's floating up there. Yeah, I don't. I don't know why, lore-wise, he would just leave shit as it is. Because, yeah, Cathay is, like, shit serious right now. It's not necessarily the end times, but shit serious. And you'd think, you know, the Dragon Daddy would want to come down and, slap some sense into his, bullshit stupid kids. But,
to fight for me is an honor.
I guess he's got better things to do.
None may refuse my call. Serve me. Serve the Emperor.
Okay, there we go. We're gonna have 4 turns of recruitment, and then we'll get a pretty big army. You know what? Fuck it.
When Miao Ying asks,
actually, hang on. What about you?
Answer. The defense effort has need.
Yeah, we'll go with her. There we go. Four turns of recruiting, and then Miao Ying will have a full army there. Good stuff. Good stuff. Good stuff. Good stuff. Actually, Warden, let's just get rid of those peasants there. 2 turns. The beautiful. We'll be able to replace those guys in a hot minute.
They refuse my call.
There we go. And then we'll just get some Jade Warrior dudes. Some of the Jade Warrior crossbowmen to back up there instead of using the dumb fucking peasant archers. Because you know what? They're dumb fucking peasants. Considering that a major demon is at the wall, he should start kicking the brats off his lawn. Yeah, I think...
Speak to me. I speak also to the Celestial Emperor.
If memory serves, I believe he's you know what, yeah, I've got loads of money. If memory serves, I think the explanation is...
Favored.
Genuinely, basically what I would call the God Emperor defense. Oh, yep, and he's reached the end. And we got the Von Karstein Blade. Which there, yep, gives... It adds Vampiric Corruption to an area that I'm in, but it also adds melee attack, frenzy, and regeneration. Just quite a good thing. Also, this is a fun little thing, but we can't do it right now, but you can actually fuse together... the items and stuff that you acquire through battle, which is interesting to get a higher thing. I think they have to be the same type of item and the same rarity. Yeah, so if we had like 2 enchanted items, we could fuse those. 2 pieces of armor, common armor, we could fuse those. It's an excellent way of like actually making sure you can find some shit that you can actually use, rather than doing what, let's be honest, tended to happen.
The majestic defender.
Hang on, give me a hot minute here, love. I'm just gonna real quick
fly the black and silver.
Send you over there, just so you can actually reinforce this guy.
Leave me to my manipulations.
God, I hope she's in reinforcement range of that. God, you have no idea how hard I hope she's in reinforcement range of that.
Serve me, serve the Emperor.
Really fucking hoping. And you know what? Let's go with cargo capacity.
A worthy addition to my arsenal.
Oh yeah, and there's Castle Drakenhof. It is just the Empire in general. Yeah. Just so you can, I think, see much more clearly the differences here in like the way the maps look. Like you can recognize this as Empire territory, but yeah, I just really like how these things look now. Like, I think the new maps are a distinct improvement over the old ones. Mock me if you must. Okay, we gotta get some fucking Yang in here before the entire fucking place burns down. So, because we got too much Yang. Gotta get some Yin. If we don't get Yin in here lickety split, we're gonna get
you stand before the
yeah, no, it's gonna
matriarch
burn down and
small.
Sink into the swamp. Did she just fucking say supreme matriarch? Because now we've got two motherfuckers in the game calling themselves the Supreme Patriarch. You know, because fucking Castalton calls himself the Supreme Patriarch as well. We don't need a Supreme Matriarch. Too many. Too many.
We're dead, aren't we?
Yeah. I don't think there was any way of winning that. Shit. We may be in trouble. Yeah, we just ever so slightly may be in trouble. Okay. Let's recruit a lord real quick. Just real quick, recruit a lord real quick. What do we need? We need Yen.
I shall restore harmony. What madness is this?
Okay. I'm guessing the Dragon Emperor defense is that Cathay's too big. No, it's that he's working on mysterious things in his tower and cannot be disturbed.
Service is
that's the dragon. That's that's the Emperor God Emperor defense.
Loyalty,
which is, if memory serves, what he's described as doing throughout like the Horus Heresy. You know, when his literal empire's tearing itself apart, it's like why the Emperor doesn't get involved in that. And I think that's more or less the explanation. For the Dragon Emperor is that he's
dragon-blooded sugar.
A trader from the Avera begs to part with you. She has what's supposed to be the very first brick laying the Great Bastion, still on the way on its construction, only now unearthed. Yeah, give it back. How did you early access? Because I held someone from Creative Assembly at gunpoint. Is how I early access.
To serve me is a privilege.
I know. I should be ashamed, but that's how I early access.
Service is every Cathayan's duty. I expect loyalty, efficiency, and harmony. I will not tolerate sloth. To serve me is a privilege. Serve and honor your ancestors.
Yeah, I believe that that's the defense for why the Dragon Emperor isn't getting involved. Is he's busy with his secretive plans. Honestly, I'm realizing the fact that we went and got the Snake Gate when we did has 100% fucked me over. Yeah, that's 100% fucked us. That's fucked us hard. Oh, fuck. Which means there's a solid chance that when I stream this again, I might actually end up starting again and not doing that. I'll have to decide later. Sermon of Siege, Nangao. Is that stopping
Lord
me from recruiting?
Yin and Yang.
Yeah, it's that's stopping me from getting my
that
particular
loyalty,
selection of fancy lads there, which
harmony.
Isn't ideal. Okay.
Service is every Cathayan's duty. To serve me is a privilege.
Okay, but if we bugger. Let's go to the Warpstone Desert. If we can hold out. For a couple of turns, we might be able to. If the mines of Nanyang hold out for a little bit, we might be. For literally just two turns, enough time for us to get that army back. We might be good. We need more fucking. We need more Yang. We need yet further Yang. So let's get some harmonic discipline. Oh no, wait, no, we need yin, don't we? Yeah, we need yin. For some reason, and this is apparently a very common misconception, and it's one I always fall into. For whatever reason, when it comes to yin and yang, people think white is yin and black is yang, when it's the other way around. I don't know why I thought that for a very long time.
Natural authority.
Okay. Get the fuck out of here.
Dragon leads you now.
Okay, we've got the dragon back. Dragon. We've got the dragon back. We're good. Everything's good. Everything's good. We can dispatch a caravan again. I don't even know where to send this one. Fucking Altdorf? Yeah, sure. Wait, is there somewhere dumb I can send him? Anyone meme? I mean, we could send him to go talk to the, No, we can't send that. We can't actively send them into Orc territory? No? Okay. You know what? Let's, What about... That's not kids' level. Wait, where's... Can we not actively send them to... Okay, we can send them to Erengrad. Which, yeah, okay, Erengrad is owned by Kislev, though it's not actually Kislev. Off you go, fella.
We must bring order to disorder.
Okay, now, as
Trust
long as
the
they...
Allies.
Yep,
what
hi, how you doing? Yes, alright.
You haggle.
You haggle like a foreigner. Let's get him. Mostly because I want to confederate him. I've not really done much in the way of confederation. As of yet. But I want to confederate him so I can get him in my army. Ah, shit. Is the Great Bastion under attack? Ah, shit. Who's gonna attack? Is it you?
Never.
Nope, you're actually just Chaos Warriors. Is it you? Are you gonna attack? You're probably gonna attack. Ah, well, we'll worry
the
about that later.
Chosen daughter. Might
all right, come on. Let's try to just get Nanyang back, and then we'll call it.
My siblings.
Unless we have to fight a Grand Bastion attack, in which case we'll do that. Okay, they ran away. They ran the fuck away.
For the
yes,
dragon.
Defensive alliance, thank you. And you know what, since we're in a defensive pact... Here's what we're gonna do. Hang on. Cavern encountered the toll. Up ahead, strewn across the road, described by bandits, stand across the blockade, demanding cargo. Yeah, fight them. Why would I possibly pay? Wait, what's besieged? Nanli. Motherfuckers! God! I forgot about the rebel lords to the south. Ugh, okay.
When Miao Ying asks, you answer. Weakness is not tolerated.
If this is the dragon's will.
The defense effort has need.
Ugh. Okay, here's what we're gonna do. This isn't fucked. We can unfuck this. We can't send that. We can accept some missions from them. Yeah, this is a way to get this allegiance. Allegiance develops over time anyway, while you're in an alliance with someone, but you can specifically defeat armies to get allegiance as well. You know what? I'll accept this allegiance mission. We're not actually even gonna build, an outpost with them, because I don't think there's much point building outposts with people you're allied to. However, we are going to call that there. Just always like calling my thing shit like that. And I'm going to check to see how this looked after the fact. to just see how the actual stream ended up like playing, because I genuinely can't know, because sometimes OBS just looks a lot worse than the final stream does for some reason, so I'll have a look. If I think it looked like absolute steam and dog shit, I will continue this in recordings. If I think it looked fine, I will continue streaming this. I may be back tomorrow night, I may leave it for tomorrow, I'm not sure. But yeah, in fucking summary, Total Warhammer 3, fucking excellent. Incredible. There is no point in playing the other ones. It's a great starting point. Like, if you're new to the series, because it's got the prologue and it's got all this other stuff, and also just the individual factions are a lot cooler. I can't imagine I'm going to be reinstalling Total Warhammer 2 ever. Because I'm gonna go ahead and guess that the, you know, the Mortal Empires equivalent that combines all three games is going to come out before I get bored of the content that is currently in Warhammer 3. And I genuinely, I can't wait to see everything, you know, in this version of the game. Because just the bare bones, this ignoring the new factions, ignoring the new class, the units, ignoring all that, the bare bones of the game are drastically improved over Warhammer 2. You know, the diplomacy, the settlement battles, the sieges, it's all drastically improved. It's just so much better on a bare bones way. So that even if they barely change anything in when bringing the new faction, the old factions in, which for a while I think may very well be the case, the new stuff alone will make it a lot better. Also, unlike Warhammer 2, while you can obviously see the age of especially the units from Warhammer 1, unlike what happened to them with Warhammer 2, Warhammer 3 doesn't appear to have fucking destroyed the assets. They don't look terrible, like they did in Warhammer 2. So, like, shit like the Empire, the Greenskins, all that stuff, will still actually, you know, actually looks better in Warhammer 3 than they looked in Warhammer 2. So, yeah. Shit's looking great. Can't wait to play more of it. Can't wait to see how this game's going to develop over time. If you're interested in helping me get a better graphics card so that I can run this game better, stream this game better, as I've been saying the last few times I've been streaming, there are links in my Discord, on my Twitter, and under my YouTube videos where I upload these on my YouTube channel, to where you could donate to my PayPal to help me out with that, to help me get a new graphics card faster. Hope you guys enjoyed the stream. I will see you again soon for some more, but that is going to be all for me for now, and I'll see you next time. Bye!
Of the worker alone, so left to three, so left to three, to the work that we must do. March on in the workers' united front, for you are a worker too.